Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Penn State Health Medical Group, Berks Cardiology.
Good evening. Welcome to Heart to Heart. This is Dave Spector with my buddy, Dr. Andy Waxler, and we get the privilege of being the first live show on TV in the new studio. And this studio is great. Looks right out on Penn Street. Daytime shows are going to be fun in here for producers, or they're going to be terrible because they're going to be distracted by
people will be knocking
everything
on the window.
Everybody walking by. Welcome back. It's great to be back. Andy, welcome back. It's fun.
Yeah, this is very cool. As Dave said, this is a beautiful new studio. And, you know, we got to get used to where to look for the camera and all. This is all new to us. But anyway, yeah, well, thank you for joining us for the inaugural BCTV show in the new studio at 4th and Penn on the new Alvernia campus. Just thought I would.
No phone, no live calls yet, but we're hoping to, when we're back on in December, to be able to take live calls in one way or another.
So Dave's friends will not be able to call in today. So
we're going to talk about aspirin. There's been something in the news lately, or something even in today's paper, about low-dose aspirin. At one time, you used to read, just take a baby aspirin every day as a precaution, no matter what. It seems like not really no matter what.
Right. So this is another example of the media, and I guess we're now part of the media being at BCTV, but the national media doing what they do, which is they take a small story, they blow it out of proportion, and they spin it so that it just confuses the patients. So about once a year, something like this happens, and our phones blow up, people call constantly, and you know, there's a lot of anxiety. And unfortunately, this is another one of those examples. So let's talk about aspirin there, shall we, Professor?
Let's talk about aspirin.
So first of all, what's important to tell you and to tell all of our viewers is that cardiovascular disease is the number one killer in the United States. Even last year during the height of the COVID pandemic. So more people die, whether you're a man or a woman, every year from heart attacks than all cancers lumped together. And again, last year with the COVID pandemic and all
heart
that.
Heart attacks, strokes, and everything cardiovascular related.
Yes, and let me clarify that. He's right, Dave's right. I made the comment a moment ago that the number one killer of men and women over the age of 40 is cardiovascular disease. And he included strokes and other things. He's correct. But the vast majority of cardiovascular deaths are coronary artery disease, which means blockage in the heart arteries causing a heart attack. So again, the number one killer is cardiovascular disease, but the main chunk, and I can't remember the percentage, but it's probably 60 or 70, something like that percent. The main portion of cardiovascular deaths are from heart attacks, and heart attacks come from blockage, hardening of the arteries, what we call coronary disease. So it's important, before we talk about aspirin, that everybody realizes that your number one threat out there, if you're 40 or older, or let's just say you're 35, you're going to be 40 or older real soon. It goes fast, Dave.
Really?
Dave and I are old. We're getting up there, and time goes fast. The point I want to make is that cardiovascular disease, particularly coronary artery blockage and heart attacks, is our number one health enemy. No question. I mean, that's not up for debate. The facts are the facts. Not me personally, but it was discovered like approximately 80 or 100 years ago that aspirin thins the blood. How does it thin the blood? It thins the blood because it makes the platelets less sticky. What are platelets? Platelets are little things that cruise around your blood, Dave, and my blood, and everybody else's blood, and they help to form blood clots. Why is that important? Well, if you're a man and you shave your face, which Dave does not do, I did this morning, or if you're a lady who shaves your legs or whatever, you know, anybody who gets any kind of injury, I'm just trying to come up with an example, any kind of bleeding that you have, platelets are important. They save your life, okay? So let's be clear. 100% of us would bleed to death at some point. I mean, who hasn't, like, you know, got a paper cut on their finger or whatever? All of us have little bleeding problems that come up, and without platelets, we would all die. So platelets are good so that you don't bleed to death. Platelets, however, are bad in that they can be activated and cause this clump of platelets leading to blood clotting in the heart arteries, which causes a heart attack. So if a patient says to me, are platelets good or bad? My answer is yes, they're both. And so that's the thing. You need some platelets so you don't bleed to death, but there are certain people that tend to form clots inside their heart arteries and have a heart attack, or inside their carotid or brain arteries and have a stroke. So aspirin is good because it makes the platelets stick together less efficiently, so they don't stick, they're not as sticky, they don't clump together, you get less clotting. What happens when you get less clotting, Dave? You get more bleeding.
Now, we're talking low-dose aspirin in general here.
Correct.
But any aspirin is going to have the same effect, but...
Well, it's like anything. The more aspirin, the more effect you have.
Okay.
But yes, of course. So, yes. So, but the take-home message here is that platelets are good for you to a certain extent, but certain people that have had recurrent blood clots in their heart arteries, which is a heart attack, or in their carotid arteries in the neck, or smaller arteries in the brain, that causes a stroke. You want those people on aspirin. We've known this for decades. This is not new information. So, Dave, when I was in medical school, which is in the late 80s, people used to say exactly what Dave just said a couple of minutes ago. Maybe if we all took an aspirin a day, we wouldn't have heart attacks and strokes. You know the old expression, an apple a day keeps the doctor away.
Right.
So some people started to think, well, maybe an aspirin a day keeps the doctor away. So funny enough, in 1989, I actually went and pulled this because I didn't want to just trust my memory. In 1989, December 28th, 1989, my summary page isn't here, doggone it. But either way, I do remember it. There was something called the Physician's Health Study. The Physician's Health Study, unfortunately, like I said, I don't have my summary, but it doesn't matter. I remember it. It came out when I was a medical student. It was a landmark, groundbreaking trial where they took male physicians, I forgot the age range, but I think it was like 30 to 60, you know, somewhere sort of young to middle age, and they gave half of them a 325 aspirin every other day, and the other half got placebo. So imagine that you...
What's a 325 aspirin?
It's a full aspirin.
Okay.
Yeah. So a regular standard aspirin is 325 milligrams. The, what we call, Dave and I, in our generation, we used to call baby aspirin until it was discovered that you shouldn't give babies aspirin. But when Dave and I were young, it was called a baby aspirin. Now we call it a low-dose aspirin, 81 milligrams daily. But either way, this landmark study, which came out in 1989, David, that's 32 years ago, showed that healthy, young to middle-aged men physicians who took an aspirin every other day had the following. Number one, slightly less non-fatal heart attacks. So there was a slight decrease in the amount of small heart attacks by taking an aspirin. So that sounds good. However, that was balanced out by an increase of intracranial bleed. And the bottom line is the survival was equal. So let me say again. A study 32 years ago showed that in young to middle-aged healthy men taking they did a 325, a full aspirin every other day, but you can kind of extrapolate to, that's probably, we'd get similar results if you took an 81 milligram every day. There was slightly fewer small heart attacks. You know, who cares? That's not gonna change your life. A small heart attack, you're not gonna die from, but increased bleeding in the brain, which is bad, and equal mortality. So I decided right then and there, the heck with that. Why would I want to take an aspirin every day? And so we've known this for 30 years. And the mistake that the people are making out there because of the misleading news is what we're talking about here is what's called primary prevention. Primary prevention, David, means if you've never had a heart problem before. So we're not talking heart patients. Right now, knock on wood, I'm not yet a heart patient. I have risk factors. I have to be careful. But if you're not a heart patient yet and you want to go into prevention mode, taking an aspirin every day is not the right thing to do. We've known this for 30 years. So the United States Preventive Task Force put out an announcement yesterday that they were adjusting their recommendations, which already said this. So this is not new, but the news media said, oh my God, this is new news. It wasn't really new news.
Yeah, but the announcement said we are adjusting.
They made a
so
small
that sounds
adjustment.
Like, that sounds like new news because they're making some kind of change.
They made a very subtle change in their recommendation. And basically the recommendation now says for primary prevention, and this is important that everybody out there understands, they are talking about primary prevention. For the love of gosh, do not, if you have a history of heart attack, if you have a history of bypass, if you have a history of a stent, don't stop your aspirin, you could die. So you are what's called secondary prevention. So people that have a heart history, who come see me as a heart doctor because they've had two heart attacks 20 years ago, and we're trying to prevent the next one, stay on your 81 milligram aspirin, because the risk of bleeding is not zero, it's not, it's small, but the benefit is big. Now, if you're me, I'm 55, I don't yet have a heart history, although someday I probably will. It says here, and I quote, the decision to initiate low-dose aspirin, that's 81 milligrams, for primary prevention of cardiovascular disease in adults 40 to 59, that's me, Dave, who have a 10% or greater 10-year risk should be an individual one. Evidence suggests that the benefit is small. Persons who are not at high risk of bleeding may benefit. So they made the recommendations very sort of squishy and wishy-washy, and they're saying from 40 to 59, people at high risk of heart attacks. Who are at high risk of heart attacks? Diabetics, smokers, people that have big-time family history. So if you're a diabetic smoker with a big family history, well, first of all, the first thing you should do is stop smoking. But that would be the most important thing you could do. That would be more beneficial than taking an aspirin. But the point is, high-risk primary prevention, they're saying it's reasonable to take a baby aspirin, but they're saying other people probably should not. David, this is what I've been saying for 30 years.
Well, when they say high-risk, they're including people who've never had any kind of cardiac problems before.
Right, this is primary prevention, right.
But are they saying if you're a smoker or a diabetic that you should be taking the baby aspirin even
nope.
if you've got no other problems?
Nope, they're saying that you should have an individual conversation with your doctor. There are ways that we can calculate your risk. There's something called a pooled cohort equation, which I'm not gonna go into, but there's a formula that we can plug a few things in and it gives us a general idea of what is your risk. And I was simply saying that people with diabetes and smoking and strong family history and severe high cholesterol, these people are at high risk for coronary blockage and heart attacks. And those people, if you're between 40 and 59, you should have a one-on-one conversation with your doctor.
So they're still not saying those people should, by definition, go on the baby aspirin, but they are saying,
but they're also not saying,
you need to talk to your doctor and with him or her make a joint decision by weighing the pluses and the minuses.
That's correct. So they're not saying that those people should go on a baby aspirin, but they're also not saying they shouldn't. And that's what's being spun by the media. Now, over the age of 60, they're saying you probably should not go on a baby aspirin for primary prevention. Why? Because the older a person gets, not only does the risk of blockage go up, but the risk of bleeding goes up. So again, if you're not yet a heart patient, if you think you're trying to prevent something, There's good ways to prevent seeing a heart doctor. Number one, stop smoking. Number two, walk every day. Number three, eat a good diet. Number four, lose weight. Number five, see your family doctor. Get things checked like your cholesterol, your blood pressure, and your sugar to make sure you're not diabetic. So again, don't smoke, see your doctor and get checked out, and do the other things that we always preach, exercise and diet. That's so much more beneficial than a baby aspirin. And that's the take-home message. But the message we want to drive home to all of you out there is, if you've had bypass surgery, if you've had a stent, if you've had a heart attack, and you're seeing a heart doctor every 6 months or every 12 months, don't stop your baby aspirin because of the news.
First off, don't stop or start anything just because of the news without talking to your doctor.
100%. 100% correct. Call your doctor. Now, our phones were off the hook today because people were calling, and that's okay. I mean, it's overwhelming to our nurses and secretaries. But again, that's okay. We want you to call. Call if you see us in Berks Cardiology, call us. If you see some other doctors, call them. But either way, don't just stop medicines on your own. And so, you know, it's a shame because the news media, I think they mean well, but, you know, they sensationalize a story. And my concern is, are people going to stop aspirin and be harmed? Like, for instance, within the first 6 months of getting a stent in your heart artery, if you stop aspirin, most people about 2 to 3 days later will clot that stent and have a big heart attack. So within the first few months of a coronary stent, it is life or death to take your aspirin. And that's my concern, David, is are people going to read these articles or watch the news and make the potentially life-ending mistake of stopping their aspirin? So don't do it.
But this is something we've been stressing all along, is for people when they've got some medical concerns, or they read something, or they hear it on the radio, or the TV, or their iPad, or whatever. Talk to your GP.
Talk to your doctor.
I mean, we've been doing this for years, telling people the GP is the captain of your ship. Talk to your GP. If you've also got a cardiologist or any other specialists, make sure your GP knows what's going on and he can coordinate all of this stuff. But don't just make these kind of decisions. Don't make it based on what we're telling you. We're telling you whatever you're doing right now, don't stop.
Right.
Or don't start something new.
And again, I want to emphasize that, yes, there is a small risk of harm from an aspirin. There is a small risk of internal bleeding. But I'm telling you, if you're within 6 months of a coronary stent and you stop your aspirin, there's a big risk you're going to have a big heart attack and die. So it's real simple. Don't stop the aspirin, especially within 6 months of a stent.
The stent's an intruder, which is going to attack. Right. It's going to attract clotting.
That's exactly right.
And that's the reason you're taking the aspirin to start with.
Got to take the aspirin in that case. So let me just make one other point here, Dave, before we run out of time, and that is everything, and I mean everything we do as doctors, especially cardiologists, but actually human beings in general, everything that we do, we are weighing the risks and the benefits, right? So those of you out there who are watching this show, when you want to walk across the street because your car is parked on the other side of the street, your brain is factoring in subconsciously, well, I could step in a pothole and break my ankle. I could get hit by a car. I could get struck by lightning. I don't know. I'm just making stuff up at this point. But the trade-off is I got to get my car, and it's on the other side of the street. So you're constantly weighing the risks and benefits. So there's a small risk of walking across the street, but the benefit is big because you've got to get to your car and drive home. Again, same thing with aspirin, right? There's a small risk of bleeding if you take an aspirin, but if you've had a heart attack, a stent, or a bypass, especially within the first 6 months of a stent, the benefit is huge. It keeps you alive. So you gotta weigh the risks and benefits. Life is not black or white, it's shades of gray. And so we've learned in the last 30 years is a healthy guy like myself or Dave, don't take a baby aspirin because you don't need to. And all you're doing is exposing yourself to that small but real risk of bleeding without any benefit. I mean, really, that's what it comes down to.
And if you're not sure the risks and benefits, that's why you're talking to your GP or your cardiologist. I mean, we're saying cardiologist as one particular specialist because we're talking cardiovascular disease tonight. But otherwise, if you're on any other kind of medication, you're not sure, why am I taking this? Talk to whoever prescribed it.
Right. I say that every day to my patients. If you have a problem with a medicine, call the doctor who prescribed it, and he or she can help you. For instance, there's a prostate medicine that causes 100% of my patients to get dizzy. They come in, they say, "Doc Waxler, why am I dizzy?" I look at their medicines, I say, "It's the prostate medicine, but I'm not, but do not stop it. I'm telling you the answer. I want you to call the doctor who prescribed it and ask him or her, do you have any other suggestions?" So the take-home message is nobody, not even another doctor, should make decisions. Always call the doc who prescribed it and ask him or her. And you know, everything is a conversation. It may take a couple days for him or her to get back to you, but that's okay.
If you're taking multiple medications prescribed by several different specialists, go to your GP.
Right.
We keep calling him the captain of the ship, him or her.
Him or her.
Just because they should know what's going on and understand all of your conditions. They also should know whatever medications you are taking for each particular condition. And by the same token, your pharmacist should be able to say, "Hold it, they just prescribed this. This doesn't work with this other one. What's going on here?" And the pharmacist should be calling back
to the physician
and saying, "Hey, he's on A, B, C, and D. Why are you giving him F on this situation? We're concerned." If you're concerned, when the doctor says to you, "I want you to start taking this medication," don't be afraid to look at him and say, what are the possible side effects?
Right.
Now, in today's litigious society, they're going to take 10 minutes to read you all of the possible side effects. But you should be able to look at the doctor and say, "Doc, realistically, what are the possible side effects? Here's what I'm taking." You should have a list when you go in to see every GP specialist or whomever, and they should be asking, when you go in, what medications are you taking?
And we always do, and that's a good point, David. We get frustrated if the patients don't bring their medication list. We ask them, please always bring your medication list, because if you're on a water pill and you're filling up with fluid and I want to up your water pill, I need to know where you are now, right? So I can't know what to adjust you to if you don't know what you're taking now. I mean, it's simple. It's kind of common sense, you know? I'm trying to help you, so you got to tell me where are we now, and then where are we going to? It's like taking a trip. You know, you can't look at a map. You got to know where you're starting before you know where you're going. And, it is important that you know your medicines. And the other thing, along the lines of what Dave just said, I see patients in the office at least once a week this happens, where they were in the hospital and some other doctor who perhaps I don't know stopped this pill and started this pill. And I say to the patient, "Why did they stop this pill?" And half the time they say, "I don't know." I'll tell you what I tell all of my patients is, if somebody wants to start a new pill or stop an old pill, ask why. I'm not saying you have to get into an argument with the doctor, or certainly not a fist fight, but you're entitled to why. You should say, "Well, I don't understand. Why are we stopping my water pill?" And the doctor may say, "Well, you're dehydrated and we don't want you to get too dried out." Okay, but at least you should know why. It's your body. You should say, "Why are we stopping this pill?" And if the doctor can't give you an explanation, then you should say, "What's going on here?" So the point I want to make is I want all of you to be informed, educated consumers. You need to know your body. You need to know what you're putting into your body. And you need to know why a doctor is making a change. That being said, please don't go changing things on your own. Have a conversation, right? We actually called it, there's a new term now. I've been doing this for 25 years, David. They now have a term in medicine called shared decision making. That's the official way of saying, if you're the patient, I would say, "David, I could put you on an aspirin. There's a 1 in 1,000 chance you're going to have an internal bleeding. But since you just had a stent," and he hasn't had a stent, I'm pretending here. "If you don't take your aspirin, you're going to have a blood clot in your stent and die." And you're going to say, "Oh my gosh, give me the aspirin." This is what's called shared decision making. Again, everybody, there's new words for everything every day there's a new term on the news. So we've been using that in medicine for about 5 years now. I've actually been doing it for 25 years. Well, it means you're a team.
Be a proactive patient.
Right.
don't be afraid to ask questions.
You're a team.
You're entitled to it.
Yeah,
you should know what's going on. Don't be afraid of the doctor.
Remember, you and the doctor are a team. That's what I tell all my patients. We're a team. I have expertise, because this is what I do. I can't change the oil in my car, but I know cardiology, right? Everybody, I believe that everybody knows certain things. We all contribute to society, right? Everybody's got their expertise. Again, I don't know how to, you know, I can barely change a light bulb, and my wife will, you know, back me up on that. I'm not good around the house. But I know the heart.
A pleasure.
Wait, are we out of
time?
Thank
you for joining us. Yep, we're out of time. We got the sign. Joan flashed us the sign. We'll see you again
this
in 2 months.
Such a beautiful studio.
Hopefully, we're going to be able to take callers, or come springtime, people can walk by on the street and hold up questions for us.
Hopefully, the Eagles are going to beat Tom Brady tomorrow night.
Good luck.
We'll see.
Hey, I'm on a roll. I just need 8 more.
I'm a sports fan, a Philly sports fan. I have to be an eternal optimist.
I hear you.
It's painful. Hey,
thanks again, folks. We look forward to talking to you again in 2 months.
Bye.
Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Penn State Health Medical Group, Berks Cardiology.